Assalamu alaikum and hello. It's nice to see you again. In this video, I would like to talk about shallow foundation subjected to eccentric load. When we talk about eccentric load, it means the load is not acting at the centroid of the footing. It acts at a distance away from the center of the footing. Let's take a look at this diagram. Let's say this is the footing, square footing or triangular footing with the dimension of B multiplied by L. B is the width, L is the length of the footing. And then this footing is subjected to vertical load Q. In addition to vertical load Q, there's a moment M counterclockwise. So this condition, we have a vertical load as well as a moment counterclockwise. It equals to the condition on the right hand side here with the similar footing, similar dimension, B multiplied by L, and then in this case we have a vertical load Q, but it acts away from the center of the footing. Let's say the distance here from the center of the footing to the load here is E. So this condition, if we refer to the center of the footing here, there's a distance E, then we have a vertical load Q, it will result in a moment in the direction of counterclockwise. So in this case, we have vertical load as well as moment in the direction of counterclockwise, similar to this condition on the left hand side. Okay. And then we look at the figure at the bottom here. Let's take a look at the stress distribution here. The stress distribution below the base of the footing. So since the footing is subjected to vertical load and moment counterclockwise, we can imagine that this footing tends to rotate counterclockwise as well. So the stress distribution no longer uniform. So on the right hand side of the footing, the stress is less than the stress on the left side of the footing due to the moment. Okay? So if the minimum stress due to the footing is positive, and then on the left hand side the maximum is also positive, so in this case, we refer to when the eccentricity E is less than B over 6. On the other hand, if the value of E, the eccentricity, is greater than B over 6, we will have this condition. On the left hand side, the Q max, right, is under compression, but on the right hand side, we get negative stress, meaning the soil is under tension. If this is the case, when E greater than B over 6, we'll get tension in soil, then this condition is no good, not desirable. So we have to redesign. Okay? Then, in terms of the effectiveness of the footing, Mayhoff suggests that the effective area is as shown by the shaded area. So let's say the eccentricity is in B direction. So the dimension of B is being reduced by 2E. Okay? And then since the eccentricity is in B direction, no eccentricity in L direction, so the dimension of L here remains as L. So we have here the effective area becomes B prime, which is equal to B minus 2E multiplied by L. Okay, referring to the previous diagram and explanation, so now we have to follow Mayhoff's effective area method to calculate the ultimate bearing capacity of a shallow foundation subjected to eccentric load. There are several steps that we have to follow. The first, we have to determine the eccentricity, E, which is equal to moment divided by the vertical load. So moment equals to load multiplied by the distance, perpendicular distance. So in this case, eccentricity equals to moment divided by the vertical load. So we have to check that eccentricity E should be less than or equal to B over 6. If the value of E greater than B over 6, then we have a condition whereby there's a tension below the footing, tension in soil, where soil cannot take tension. So that is undesirable. So we have to make sure that the value of E less than or equals to B over 6. After we have obtained the value of E, then we have to determine the effective dimensions. Okay? If the eccentricity is in B direction, so the effective B, B prime, equals to B minus 2 multiplied by eccentricity in B direction. B minus 2 multiplied by E sub B. Then L prime is equal to L. Now we are talking about one-way eccentric load in B direction. So this is the condition. In B direction, B prime equals to B minus 2E and L prime equals to L. Let's say the eccentric load is in L direction. So B prime, the effective dimension, B prime equals to B. Whereas for the L prime equals to L minus 2E sub L, eccentric in L direction. So we have two different conditions here, either in B direction or in L direction. Step number 3, we have to determine the ultimate bearing capacity using Meyerhoff-Hansen equation. So if you remember, the ultimate bearing capacity Q sub U equals to CNC FCS FCD FCI plus QNQ FQS FQD FQI plus 1/2 gamma B N sub gamma F gamma S F gamma D F gamma I. Since we are talking about effective area method, for the Q sub U, we put prime to indicate effective ultimate bearing capacity. In addition to that, B here, we use B prime, effective dimension. Q U prime, B prime here. But take note that Q here should be calculated in effective stress, in terms of effective stress. Okay, and then in calculating the ultimate bearing capacity, the effective ultimate bearing capacity, you have to use effective dimensions to obtain shape factors. Use effective dimensions to obtain shape factors. For the depth factors, use the original dimension. Don't change to effective dimensions. Only shape factors that you have to use, effective dimensions. Right? After we have obtained all the parameters, all the factors, then we can calculate the ultimate load. Capital Q, but we have to put prime here to indicate the ultimate load in terms of effective, because we are talking about effective area, equals to Q sub U prime that we have obtained in step 3, and then multiply by the effective area, B prime multiplied by L prime. If you are required to calculate loud alert, then you have to divide this Q sub U prime by safety factor. Let's take a look at an example. A footing is subjected a vertical load Q net allowable and a moment in the direction of counterclockwise. This is a square footing, 2 meters by 2 meters, and the depth of footing 2 meters. So the soil properties, unit width of the soil equals to 18 kN per meter cube, the internal friction angle equals to 30 degrees, C equal to 0, again it indicates cohesionless material or granular material like sand or gravel. So in terms of loadings here, the Q net allowable, the vertical load, equal to 1200 kN and the moment equals to 300 kN. Right, the problem here is assuming one-way eccentric load in B direction. Okay, in B direction, we have to check whether the footing is safe to carry the load with the safety factor of 2.5. Okay, let's solve the problem. The first step is to determine the eccentricity E. E equals to the moment divided by the load, M divided by load, Q net allowable. Here, basically is moment divided by load. Moment equals to 300 kN divided by the Q net allowable, 1200 kN. So the eccentricity equals to 0.25 m. So after we have obtained the value of E, then we have to check whether this value E less than or equals to B over 6 or E greater than B over 6. So B over 6, the initial width of the footing, equals to 2 meters divided by 6, equal to 0.33 m. So in this case, E is less than B over 6. So E less than B over 6. So it's okay. The next step is to determine the effective dimension of the footing due to the eccentric load or due to the eccentricity. So B prime equal to B minus 2E. Since in the problem it was stated that the eccentricity is in B direction, then B, which equals to 2 meters minus 2, E here is 0.25 meter. So B prime equals to 1.5 meter. The effective length, L prime, remains as L because the eccentricity is in B direction. So L prime, the effective length of the footing, remains as L. Before we start calculating the ultimate bearing capacity, let's find the values of the bearing capacity factors. So in this case, we refer to internal friction angle equals to 30 degrees. And again, remember, we are solving this problem using Meerhof's method. So we have to use Meerhof's equation. Then you have to refer to table if you use this book. Should be on page 60. Meerhof's table for the bearing capacity factors. Okay. So if you refer to this book, so N sub Q equals to 18.40, N gamma equals to 22.40. So if you don't have this book, you may refer to any geotechnical engineering book, and then you can find tables or bearing capacity factors for Meyerhoff-Hansen's equation. And C, we don't have to obtain because C is equal to 0, automatically C term equals to 0, cancel out. So we remain with Q term and gamma term. Okay. Next is to calculate shape factors. So remember, when we have to calculate shape factors and it involves eccentricity, we have to use effective dimension. So take note here, use effective dimension. So FQS, we have to calculate FCS, FQS equal to 1 plus B prime over L prime tangent phi equals to 1 plus B prime, the effective dimension, equals to 1.5, and then the L prime remains as L, which is 2 meter, multiplied by tangent 30 degrees equals to 1.433. So for F gamma S equals to 1 minus 0.4 multiplied by B prime over L prime equals to 1 minus 0.4, B prime 1.5, L prime remains as L 2 meters, so equals to 0.7. Then we calculate depth factors. So for the depth factors, we have to consider two different conditions. One, df over b less than or equal to 1. And another one is df over b greater than 1. So we have to check which case that we have to refer to. Okay. So in this case, use the initial dimensions. Don't use the effective dimensions. Okay. Df over b, the depth of footing is 2 meters. And then the width of the footing is also 2 meters. So df over b, 2 over 2 less than or equal to 1. So we refer to this condition. Df over b less than or equal to 1. So fqd equals to 1 plus 2 tangent phi 1 minus sine phi squared multiplied by df over b equals to 1 plus 2 tangent 30 degrees multiplied by 1 minus sine 30 degrees squared df equal to 2, b equals to 2. So fqd equals to 1.289. F gamma d equals to 1.0. Inclination factors. Okay. Since the applied load Q net allowable is vertical, then beta equals to 0. So FQI equals to 1 minus beta divided by 90 degrees. Squared, since beta equals to 0, then FQI equals to 0. Sorry, FQI equals to 1. F gamma I equals to 1 minus beta divided by friction angle of the soil 30 degrees. Again, since beta equals to 0, so F gamma I equals to 1. Okay, let's write the ultimate bearing capacity equation. Q sub U, since we are talking about effective area method, then the ultimate bearing capacity Q sub U prime
equals to Q and Q FQS FQD FQI plus 1/2 gamma B prime
effective dimension
and gamma F gamma S F gamma D F gamma I.
C terms equal to 0 because C equals to 0. Q, this is the stress at the base of the footing due to the weight of the soil from the ground surface to the base of the footing.
So, equals to the unit weight of the soil, 18, multiplied by the depth of the footing, 2 meters, 2. So, gamma here, D sub F here. N sub Q equals to 18.4. FQS equal to 1.433. FQD equal to 1.289. And FQI equals to 1. Plus 1/2. Gamma equal to 18, the unit weight of the soil. B prime, the effective dimension, 1.5 meter. N sub gamma equal to 22.4, F gamma S 0.7, F gamma D 1, F gamma I 1. So Q sub U prime equals to 1435.22.
Again, the unit here is in term of stress, kilonewton per meter squared. After calculating the ultimate bearing capacity, the next step is to calculate the net allowable bearing capacity. Because in the problem, the load is given as Q net allowable. So let's calculate the net allowable bearing capacity. So Q net allowable, put prime here to indicate in terms of effective area method. So, Q net allowable equals to the ultimate bearing capacity minus Q divided by safety factor. Q sub U prime we have calculated, which equals to 1435.22, and then minus Q. Q here is the stress at the base of the footing equals to the unit weight of the soil multiplied by the depth of footing.
So becomes 18 multiplied by 2 divided by safety factor 2.5. So this Q net allowable equals to 559.70 kilonewton per meter squared.
This is the net allowable pressure, or the pressure that being allowed by the soil. Okay. Next, we have to check what is the maximum stress due to the eccentric load, and then what is the minimum stress. Okay. Qmax the maximum load or the maximum stress is given as vertical load divided by the dimension of the footing multiplied by 1 plus 6e divided by b. Okay, the maximum stress below the footing equals to the vertical load divided by the dimension of the footing or the area of the footing multiplied by 1 plus 6e. E is the eccentricity, B is the width of the footing. So, equals to the applied load equal to 1200 divided by the area of the footing 2 by 2 multiplied by 1 plus
6 multiplied by 0.25. 0.25 is the eccentricity. And then divided by B, 2 meters. So, the maximum stress equals to 5 to 5 kilonewton per meter squared. Okay. So this is the stress, the maximum stress due to the applied load as well as the moment. Okay, this is the stress due to the applied load and the moment. Whereas here, 559.0 is the allowable stress, the stress allowed by the soil. So in this case, we compare the applied and the allowable. So the applied is smaller than the allowable. So meaning this design so far is okay. So Qmax less than Qnet allowable. Okay, so should be okay. The applied less than the allowable. So design so far it's okay. The final step, we have to check the minimum stress due to the applied load. Q min is expressed as the vertical load divided by the area of the footing multiplied by 1 minus 6E divided by B. So equals to the applied load, vertical load, 1200 divided by dimension of the footing 2 by 2 and then multiplied by 1 minus 6 multiplied by 0.25 meter, that's the E, divided by the width of the footing B. Don't use effective dimension here, use the initial dimension. So when we calculate here, Q mean equals to 75 kilonewton per meter squared. So the Q mean here still positive, meaning greater than zero, or in other words, no tension. So should be okay. So the whole process we obtained, or we found that the E less than B over 6 should be okay. And then when we check the maximum stress due to the applied load is smaller than the allowable stress by the soil, so it's okay. And then the minimum stress due to the applied load, the number is positive, meaning the soil is under compression, no tension between the soil and the footing, then it's okay. So the whole thing, the design is okay. So the design of the footing, okay. I think that's all I want to talk about the eccentric load, and I hope everybody can follow the steps how to solve a problem involving eccentric load. Until we meet again next time, thank you.